My name is James Carpenter, and I'm the Moon Utilization and Lead for Moon Mars Science in the Directorate of Human and Robotic Exploration. So ESA is preparing the way for a long-term sustained use of the Moon for science and technology and to benefit all of humanity. And we're doing this by preparing technologies, new capabilities to go to the Moon, to learn how to live and work there, and to prepare the infrastructure that's going to be there in the future. And we're doing that with international partners and with industry and science across Europe. So in the next few weeks, we're going to see the first launch of Artemis, Artemis 1. And Artemis 1 includes the European Service Module, which is the powerhouse of the Orion vehicle. And Orion is the vehicle that's going to take humans into deep space towards the Moon for the first time since Apollo. And in this first mission, it will be uncrewed. The mission will go around the Moon and come back again. The second of these missions, Artemis 2, will carry humans around the Moon. And then the third of these missions, Orion will dock with the Gateway. And the Gateway is an orbital outpost, a human-tended orbital outpost around the Moon that ESA is working on developing now with NASA, the Canadian Space Agency, CSA, and JAXA, and other international partners may be coming involved too. And the Gateway will be used as the staging post to get down to the lunar surface, where a lander will take crew down to the lunar surface where they'll work and operate. And this will happen multiple times over the decade and beyond to come. And as we do this, we'll work on increasingly complex missions, increasingly ambitious missions, working towards this long-term sustained access and sustained activity on the lunar surface. And one of the major contributions we're going to bring to this is the European Large Logistics Lander, or Argonaut. Argonaut is a logistics vehicle. It can bring down around 1.5 tons of cargo. This cargo can be robotic systems, it can be equipment or supplies that crew can use on the lunar surface. And this will be an enabling element in this overall architecture of lunar exploration, which involves ESA, NASA, and other international partners. So the Moon is really a unique scientific opportunity. So the Moon is, if you like, an end member of planetary formation. Much of what we know about how planets form and evolve comes from the early missions to the Moon, from the samples that came back from Apollo. But what we've learned from recent orbital missions is that these samples are really from a very special area of the Moon. The Moon has a surface area about the size of Africa, and we've barely begun to explore it. And so what we now know is that in order to understand the Moon, to understand what it can teach us about the whole of the how planets form and evolve, we would need to go back to new places and bring new samples back. The Moon is also a place that has not changed very much over several billions of years. And as a result, it has accumulated and stored a record of the whole of solar system history during this time. It records the path of the solar system through the galaxy. It records the impact events that happened in the early solar system around the time when life was emerging on Earth. It records the history of our sun, and it records all of these things in a way which is accessible, the only place where they are accessible in the solar system. And so we're going to go to the Moon, we're going to explore it, we're going to use the Moon to learn about how planets formed and evolved, about the context in the solar system when life was emerging, and about the history of our solar system and our sun. One of the early developments that we're preparing now is called Prospect. And Prospect is a lunar drill. It will drill beneath the surface near the lunar south pole, and it will take samples out where they'll be go to a chemical laboratory where they'll be analyzed. Now, the really important thing about the lunar poles is we now know that there are places there that are very, very cold, and these places store water, ice, and other volatile chemistry. Now, this chemistry can teach us about the origins and evolution of life-enabling chemistry in the inner solar system, which is really important to understand the origins of life. But it's also a resource that we could use in the future. So water, ice, for example, is oxygen and hydrogen, which we can use to make rocket fuel. And so we may have large deposits of rocket fuel waiting for us at the lunar surface. But in order to know whether these are real resources or not, we first need to go there, to explore there, to take samples, to understand the abundance, the distribution, the accessibility of this water, ice, and the other chemistry that we find there. And so Prospect is one of a suite of instruments on a number of missions from ESA and international partners that are going to go to different places around the poles to explore and understand this water, ice, and the other chemistry there. So Prospect will be carried on an American US commercial mission as a partnership with NASA. In the South Polar region, it'll drill beneath the surface, take the samples, it'll heat those samples up to get all these volatiles with its water, ice and other things off it. It'll analyze the chemistry of those. It'll also perform experiments to see whether we can chemically remove some of the oxygen from the minerals that we find there too, which is a process that could lead to other ways of producing oxygen and resources on the surface of the moon. Prospect is, if you like, the parent of a family of instruments that are going to the moon now as well. Now, the first of these is a mass spectrometer. And this mass spectrometer looks at the chemistry of gases. Now, this thing started life within the overall chemical laboratory of Prospect, but this mass spectrometer now is going on a mission which should go either this year or early next year, one of the first commercial missions in NASA's Commercial Lunar Payload Services program, flying with Astrobotic. And this will measure the exosphere, the tenuous atmosphere that the moon has at the landing site where Astrobotic go. We're also flying a similar instrument as part of the Japanese LUPEX rover mission. LUPEX, again, is a rover that's going to go to the polar regions to explore water, ice and other volatiles to understand their potential as resources for the future. And so this is part of a broader spectrum of activities which we're undertaking here in ESA to understand lunar resources, to understand how we might use them in a responsible way in the future, and to develop new technologies for producing oxygen, hydrogen, rocket fuel, and even eventually metals and materials that we might be able to make on the moon too. So many of the projects, many of the activities that we are running now and preparing now have a deep Italian involvement. So the Prospect system, for example, which is going to drill into the surface and take samples to understand the resource potential and do science at the lunar poles. The drill, that the whole Prospect system is being led from Italy by Leonardo, and the drill is being developed specifically in Italy. We have a laser retroreflector, which is in development for flight to the moon in around 2024. And this laser retroreflector, which comes from Italy, from INFN, is going to allow us to test relativity from the moon and becomes part of a network of retroreflectors, some from the Apollo era, some new ones which are going to be there, which will allow us to also understand the deep interior structure of the moon and the way that the moon has formed and evolved. Italy are also majorly involved in the development of the Gateway, the habitat for the Gateway and other systems. So I think in all of this, there's a very, very deep Italian involvement, both in terms of science and technology and some of the big developments that are coming too. So if we want to send humans to Mars, there's a lot we have to learn. So we can understand the basic physics of how you send a spacecraft to Mars, but in terms of how we actually keep humans healthy and thriving and happy on the trip there, how we make sure that they survive and function in deep space, not just during the mission, but also for the years that follow. How do we make sure that they're able to live and work at the surface of Mars? How do we learn to use the local resources where we can? How do we learn to just to use the things that we find there and to live, work, function effectively in the different environments that we're going to experience? And there are many, many things about how we do this, both in terms of physiology, psychology, technology, that we just don't understand yet. We just don't know how to do this. And the moon, if you like, is a fantastic test bed. So as we explore the moon and as we learn to live and work on the moon, we will learn more and more about what it means to have humans in confined spaces, in deep space for long periods of time. We'll learn about what it means to have human physiology and all the biology we carry with us in deep space, in that environment, with that radiation, with reduced gravity, with all those other things. And as we will learn how to operate off-world in terms of the way we do operations, the way we technologies and humans work together, the way we use robots, all of these things in a holistic way is very complex, is something that's very new, and the moon is only a few days away. It's a fantastic test bed, and what we learn at the moon will be enabling for those missions to Mars. And so in that sense, we use it as a test bed to prepare for Mars. And the idea is that we go to the moon, we build up our capabilities there, moon becomes a sustained place for activity, and then we learn the lessons that we need to learn, and then we're able to also move on to Mars and have missions that will go there too.